Yeah, so I reckon, like, I was thinking about it, and I think I was the what I sent you was a little bit too, like, missing the forest for the trees, so to
Oh, that's
speak.
okay. It's still, I'm a first science podcast. It's
Exactly.
everything.
But yeah, like, I think just like, why not emphasize and go through the like and stuff and how fun and interesting it is, and then
Yeah,
you
it
can
is.
then that can be tied in a roundabout way to like alternative perspectives on things, allow you to have a better model of what, or allow a different model of what you're talking about, and so you can do your science better. So I was thinking for forest science, that's super relevant for stuff where
Exactly.
like we have not conceptualized mycorrhizal networks in any point in our culture. And so we've got no way of talking about it without talking about something else. We're either talking about, you know, an economy
Yeah.
of carbon or a worldwide web or a woodwide web or all these analogies that just hide other dimensions to it.
Oh
And
my
just
God.
making sure that we acknowledge that gives you a better chance to actually understand what the hell's
Understanding
going on.
too.
So that's
Yeah.
what I thought would be the useful point for forest science. But I also like, I haven't taken a forestry science subject. Like, I'm
Really?
just, yeah, no, like,
There's
I've, and
only
actually,
one at Uni Melbourne, I guess, the forest systems,
yeah,
and it wasn't very
yeah.
in depth.
So, yeah, like, I'm just kind of, my knowledge of forestry science comes from talking to you and filling in the blanks from the like really broad botany subjects I've
And the
done.
trees with Squill Instagram.
Exactly.
At trees with Squill. That is.
Welcome to Trees with Squill, a podcast hosted by Squillum. In this podcast, we will discuss trees, forest science, lignin, and the like. Now let's branch out and leaf it all on the table.
Hello. Hello.
Hello.
Welcome to the Trees with Squill podcast, episode 5. Today,
Sick.
it's the first interview. Dr. Finn, introduce yourself.
Thank you. I am Finn. I am not a doctor.
You are.
I am not even a tree expert. I am an environmental scientist. I've just gotten my bachelor's, so I'm not even that up there as far as scientists go. But I've got my bachelor's in environmental science and ecosystems from the University of Melbourne. I'm a queer man from Naam, Melbourne, the Kulin Nation, and I like, I mean, kind of the stuff you'd expect with environmental science. I'm really into botany and water chemistry and geology and geomorphology and just mixing together all this weird stuff and never actually end up taking a hard subject.
Yeah. For anyone wondering, Finn and I met through a friend in a geology subject. So that's
Yes.
the sign of a good friendship, in my opinion. I
It's a good connection to have.
reckon it rocks.
Perfect.
Crumbs. That was a great introduction. Finn, we were talking recently. You sent me a pretty hot essay about, let's just dive right in, is the queer lichen theory, it's called, which, I mean, was pretty abstract for me because I try and learn about philosophy, but it still links like the environment to these kind of human philosophical thoughts. And it got pretty sick, like in a good
It's really
way.
cool. It's really
Yeah.
cool. Yeah, this is an article by David Griffiths in 2015, and he is interested in a couple of earlier works by both science philosophers and kind of standard philosophers,
Yeah.
and kind of putting them together and bringing this ecological queerness into a taking a social perspective on it and using it to extend the same values that you would derive from a queer ecology
Yeah,
to a
exactly.
queer sociology, which is a nice roundabout thing because queer studies comes from obviously social and gender studies.
Yeah. So why was the queer God, tell me more about it. I
Why are lichens
haven't read it
queer?
for. Yeah, why are lichens queer?
Yeah.
That's what the people are wondering.
lichens are queer, is his contention, and it's based around the fact that lichens are some people will know that lichens are weird. Not necessarily everyone will know how to distinguish a lichen from a moss or some kind of fungus or something like that. So
yeah.
A lichen is actually a composite organism. It is composed of it's a composite organism. So there's two different living organisms coming together to make this thing. It's kind of cosmopolitan in that way. It's made up of more than one thing. And those things are a microbiont or a fungal organism that contribute to structure and the ability to obtain nutrients via attacking rock and weathering material and stuff like that. And a photobiont, which is an algae or a cyanobacteria.
Oh my God, I didn't know this. Yeah.
I was double checking everything. Sorry, was that good? And that produces sugars via photosynthesis. And so both of these two things work together to create a little system that is really important because it wouldn't work elsewhere. You can't have these cyanobacteria or the photobionts would not survive in the environments that you find lichens without the structure and safety and ability to obtain nutrients that the fungi provides, and vice versa. The ability to attain, you know, you can't mine that, you can't get all the minerals out of rocks the way that the fungal partner does without a reliable source of energy, which the photobiont provides. So
true.
They're really interesting. And one of the things that he talks about is that the idea of the individual in science and just by incident, the same time that we started developing really strong ideas around biology, especially in theory of evolution, pops up roughly around the same time that we start developing values in Victorian England about our kind of social models of being and doing, where we create the individual in that sense as well, an individual who is part of a capitalist process and a social process. And he points out that all of these, it's really important to acknowledge and understand that this social context in which we are doing science determine how we create science and what we end up getting from it.
It's very, yeah, interesting.
It's wild. And so then it took a while to work out that lichens were a holobiont and a microbiont rather than just being an individual.
Yeah, right. Because they grow so slowly. That's what I learned recently. Like, a tiny patch takes like a decade. Makes you feel bad for like exploring the forest and picking some off.
Exactly. They've just got all these different dimensions to them, which is super interesting. And so people resisted the idea that they were a symbiosis. In fact, the term symbiosis was coined to describe them.
When was that then?
Oh, 1890s.
So we're talking
roughly
some time ago. Okay. I love symbiotic relationships.
Yeah.
They're wholesome.
But like the last paper that tried to refute the idea that they were a symbiote was in the 1950s-ish.
Oh my God.
Like,
what kind? Do you know what arguments they had?
I think maybe just a stick in the mud kind of argument. You know, when scientists get cranky and decide to to rag on someone.
That's so interesting. I've been reading a book published around that time, a forest pathology one, and I just finished the fungi chapter. And even then, like, all the values or theories I had for fungi still standing today in terms of, like, their growth and absorbing nutrients and forming relationships with other hosts to gain more nutrients, which I thought was so interesting that, like, this scientific book published 70 years ago is still checking out with modern theory.
Yeah, and they were just getting around to those ideas. And so, but what became really interesting, lichens were our first entry point into the idea of symbiosis. And so they became our window into symbiosis. Things were described as a lichen-like thing to the point where I think when they found a virus inside a bacterial cell, they called it a lichen-type thing.
No doubt.
So that's how we understand, like, intimate interrelations between different species. It was through the lens of lichens. Yeah.
Nice one, science.
We got there. And then it comes full circle when we start getting through these ideas that of endosymbiosis, where Numa Gulas proposes that many different versions of the same story of two cells came together, both of which did something the other couldn't, and became irretrievably connected. So that would be chloroplasts or mitochondria or a whole host of other different examples. And now we're kind of at a point where we still have a set of values that is built around the individuals and a set of models that is built around individuals. And we talk about every version of science has it. But every time we do it in science, we kind of always know that we have an asterisk there of individual, but there's a microbiome or there is some other, there's all these different nuances to it. But I think the issue is that we don't have, is that it's an asterisk and not that we are changing our models to actually acknowledge the network that's going on rather than just continuing to pretend they're individuals for the sake of simplicity and then going, well, but there's details. So it comes full circle when we're actually able to realize that, you know, humans have, in every dimension that you could try to describe a human as an individual, there are a million examples of where we are not. Our gut bacteria, if we were to take those out, we would die immediately.
Neurons.
There are all sorts of different ways in which we are,
Just emergent properties. Yeah, that's interesting.
Yeah, it's really cool. So should I keep going on to the queer part?
Yeah, how does this all... Let's
yeah, so
queer.
That's lichens. And lichens' relationship to science. So queerness... So queer theory is a theory that evolved in the 90s, and it was a way to criticise sociological concepts. It was a kind of extension from women's studies.
The gender
and
binding,
queer theory is really loosely defined, like queerness. You know, I think... I know if you tried... if you ask me to try to define my queerness in a small set of words, it would not really work. And that's kind of the point.
That's a mood.
Yeah, right. And so the queer theory is quite vague, but it's one of the key things is that it's non-essentialist.
Do you have a definition of essentialism?
Essentialism is stretched, but you know, it's kind of in the word, right? Like it is something that is inherent. So if we were to, I might get that. Can we pause?
I'll pause. Run! That's early morning.
Not expecting that at all. I think it was a thing for Seb.
Oh, cute. Wait, where is Seb? Is he sleeping?
He's at work today.
Oh, hot.
Actually, out doing shit, unlike me, waiting for something to happen.
Babe, dude, you're on a world-class podcast.
Exactly. This is it. This is what I've been waiting for.
I've had 20 total listens, actually. So.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
That's something. That's more than we're getting with our theater shit right now. So that's... Look, this digital shit is so exponential, you know? It's just nothing at first.
Yeah.
It's tough. Sorry about that. Do you want to start from what is queer theory?
Or essentialism. I found a definition of essentialism that I'll read out, which might help
awesome.
For the listeners to conceptualize everything. So this is Wikipedia, great reference. Essentialism is the view that objects have a set of attributes that are necessary to their identity. So that's makes sense, and that helps why we're debunking some aspects of ecology theories are like, very kind of cuts across.
Yeah.
And interesting points.
You know, concept. when you get into it, like biology is something that's inherently quite non-essentialist. You know, we're not ascribing anything to anything. We're just saying that, you know, carbon molecules are going to do what they're going to do, not because they've got some inherent property, but because they just they just exist as they are. So biology is quite inherently non-essentialist. But ecology can kind of end up being a little bit like that if you're not careful when you start making these rounding errors to make this extraordinary complex system more easy to manage. Queer theory is quite non-essentialist, and what that kind of allows you to do is say that everyone is lichenized, everyone has these symbiotic relationships going on. But more so than that, it also points out that there are ways of being that are super not heterosexual. Lichens are these two species that come together, or sorry, they're not two species. This is the other weird thing about lichen biology is that they're actually just a composite of a whole bunch of different things. There's a particular branch of lichens which almost always incorporates a yeast fungus as a third. But if you were to, and this is what some scientists realized in 2015, if you were to grind up your given sample of lichen, you're just going to find a whole host of contaminated DNA when you try to sequence it. And it's not contaminated, it's part of that lichen. So it's lichen, it's described in, and so a lot of this is coming from Merlin Sheldrake's fantastic book Entangled Life, and then the papers that he references.
Yes.
But he describes it as not being about the singers, but the song. Anyone can jump in, but as long as you're all singing the same song, you can form this symbiotic relationship.
Okay.
It's a really, it's a really neat way of doing it, right?
Yeah.
Cute. But yeah, so these lichens kind of show, and they're a window for us again into all these different elements of nature. You know, often homosexuality is or other queer things are called unnatural. And then people will go, well, you know, giraffes and bats and you'll end up listing half the animal kingdom doing various queer things as if it's an exception. Trees are like, trees have sex via third parties. They are they are hermaphroditic. They
all genders
have
on
all
one
these
tree.
Different
monadiceous, stasis,
yeah, they have all these different qualities to them, which are definitively not cisnormative or heterosexual. If you wanted to apply a set of values to them. And so lichens, in the same way that they allowed us to see that everything is symbiotic or endosymbiotic, we continue to create our understanding of biology through a cisnormative, heteronormative lens. And we continue to frame, it's not that we deny that there are some gay things about nature, but that we go, okay, that's a deviation from the rule. And we always have treated it as that. It's like, okay, they're doing that for a reason. We're having sex, and everything else is having heterosexual sex for no reason in particular, other than the fact that it's right. But asexual reproduction is happening for a reason, you know. Pollinators are happening for a reason. We have to justify it. Instead, we can actually start to reconsider our making of ecology through a lens that doesn't make these assumptions and is aware of the queerness of nature. There is also this work done by Timothy Morton, and he's written some stuff about queer ecology. And our conceptualization of nature is this powerful force that we've kind of got all these different philosophical values to it. His work is a lot harder to dig into, especially if you're not philosophical, because he uses a whole bunch of words in a philosophical sense that you just need to have been an expert in Foucault to get. And I don't quite get what he's saying yeah. in his words.
Would someone like him have a philosophy background and an ecology background, or do you think he's
primarily a philosopher? I think.
Cool.
He's got a working knowledge. Not to take away from his, I think he's got a working knowledge, but his qualifications are in philosophy.
Okay.
And writing.
Like, I wonder how, you'd academically explore that. Anyway.
Yeah.
What did he say?
About the quiz? So he's got, I just want to throw this in because I'm referring to Nature, but he does a really lovely job. When you can understand what he's saying of criticizing the idea of nature as this, just this thing, you know, like defining nature is something that is always difficult to do, but there is a set of values that we tend to do it with in the West
that
is really quite problematic. And he makes these lovely points about, you know, nature is queer, nature is not, nature is disabled, and nature is queer in the sense that it is strange. It is not rational. It is not kind of going to do what you want to do. And it's not this all-powerful regulator of ways of being. It's just weird shit happening. And I don't know how to dig into that, but I want to acknowledge that criticism of our Western colonial views on nature before just saying nature and whatever else.
It could also lean into like urbanization. I was talking about this with a friend recently about disasters and stuff, like the extent to which humans believe they can just control and make new technology to avoid catastrophes. And I'm going to build a house out bush. Bushfires won't get to me because I'm a human. I control special. This.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, so he and I think his colleagues are also like doing stuff to do with the kind of ecology without nature, so to speak, and simply, you know, kind of broadening the ways that we conceptualize this stuff. So, yeah, lichens are our kind of, Griffiths is arguing that lichens are, once again, our window into reconceptualizing nature in a way that is more true to it rather than the set of social values that we've arrived at it with and have tried to apply to it.
Yeah, right. I like that. I when I was briefly looking over some things, I came across an ecofeminism theory that kind of challenges our conceptualization of nature as well, in terms of well, it's this woman named Karen Warren, and she says that there are important connections between the domination of women and the domination of nature.
Yes.
So that's another lens at looking through.
Yeah, there's actually a fantastic little intro to queer ecology, an hour-long lecture, which talks about ecofeminism and queer ecology as well and kind of compares them.
This paper... Karen Mom was quoted, but it's by Caitlin Marie Doak. She at the end was saying, oh my goodness, an anti-essentialist eco-feminist position, one that holds anti-essentialism as a worldview and is not merely non-essentializing, is a queered eco-feminism position that aligns with the philosophical endeavors of queer ecology to queer the dualisms prominent in ecological thought. And that, so it goes that on sounds, to say that, yeah,
yeah, queer, that sounds great. That sounds totally right. Ecofeminism
is like the solution to everything.
And I think as far as like reconceptualizing nature through a queer lens or an ecofeminist lens is a really good start to getting, especially because kind of a lot of this is happening through this viewpoint or standpoint of our white colonial experiences. You know, that gets us a step closer to even beginning to unpack the kind of extraordinary value you can get from Indigenous perspectives on nature and on conservation and and all of those and just ways of being. It's not, I think it's a space where we can kind of stretch our legs in doing the right thing without then intruding into another, a totally different philosophical and spiritual world that isn't really kind of appropriate.
True.
I don't know.
You don't know. And there's also the idea that it can help understand the oppression of women.
Yes, totally.
and thus, yeah, the destruction of nature.
Mm.
The treated.
There's a this video that I'll send you.
Yeah, put it in the show notes.
Absolutely. The lecturer speaks about the fact that women, especially in the Victorian era, were kind of forced into the position of being the moral center of the home. Mm. And so, therefore, there is an assumption of moral responsibility for the care of the world.
Mm-hmm.
And if we want to start doing that,
yeah,
doing environmentalism and those kind of things well,
yeah,
we need to get past the idea that women are responsible for, you know, like if women ran the world is the example she uses, that idea that the, you know, that we would just be a more moral, okay place if women were responsible for everything, but we can't just keep acting as if that's a truism and we actually need to not put all of the moral responsibility onto women for doing the right thing, because inherently you're like, okay, well, that's once again men being lazy if you want to talk about responsibility.
Yeah. Oh my gosh. I suppose so.
So yeah, and I had a couple of ideas for how to swing around these kind of perspectives to forestry science, which is not something I know an extraordinary amount about beyond what I've heard from you.
Hit me.
But the other kind of stuff that Merlin Sheldrake goes into in Entangled Life, which is a fantastic book about.
I have it.
Kind
of, I need to read it.
All, oh, it's so good. You've got to read it.
Reagan,
all these different dimensions of mycology, the study of fungi. And what he kind of goes into is this fascination that we have with mycelial networks in forests, in all sorts of different environments.
People do love them, yeah.
It's an extraordinary idea. Like
even in like non-environmental science-based communication, like just your regular dude on the street loves
to hear about it. It's a method of interstellar travel in Star Trek now.
Oh my God.
It's a really fascinating idea. But yeah. I think something to note about it is that unlike, you know, every culture, regardless of how imperialist and kind of disconnected from our values about nature we've become, we have a set of ideas and values that have developed really intimately with forestry, right? We know forest in some sense. We may have start to unlearn our relationship with forests, but we all kind of start there, right?
For sure, yeah.
Mycelial networks have been invisible for all of human history, and so we don't have we've built our understanding of the world with the preconceptions that trees and forestry has already given us. We already have those kind of ideas ready to go. We think about all sorts of different things as if they are trees. Even neurology, kind of, yeah. we've built these associate. We went to neurology and went, oh, this is tree-like. But we don't have any preconceptions for mycelial networks, and therefore we don't really have a way to describe them that is true to them. We will apply these ideas of it's like the internet, or it's like a
neural
global
network,
system of trade.
Oh yeah.
Or you know, there's analogies that are used for tree nurseries where young trees are cared for and raised by a community of older trees, as if you're going straight back to this nuclear heteronormative family kind of thing, right? There's all these different analogies that we apply to them, and the truism of science is that all models are wrong, but some are useful. But we've got to keep remembering that the models that we're using to understand these mycelial networks are not correct. They're not going to capture the whole picture. They are not a brain. They're not this. We're trying to bring these human, we're trying to put these unknowable, extraordinarily complex network into human boxes. And that's not a bad thing, but we've got to remember how limited we are by our social understanding of the world.
It almost gets like spiritual then, perhaps.
Totally. You know, as someone who is almost a-spiritual. Like, it is like trying to grasp the infinite complexity to this is really cool and really extraordinary.
Yeah. That's interesting. I didn't think about like the heteronormative like family thing in nurseries. That's so funny. Because even Dr. Suzanne Simard, I love her, but her whole theory is about like this one mother tree, which I guess is perhaps like revolutionary, like one female tree looking after the entire goddamn forest, sharing nutrients to those who are ill. That's interesting. Do you have any final things to add? Because I have one question.
Oh, I've got one extra thing that I'll add that I forgot about, which is that also, you know, a lot of these models around mycorrhizal networks are plant centric. It's about what fungi are passive workers or passive kind of servants for trees. If a tree wants to divert resources to another tree, then the mycorrhizal network does the work.
Yeah.
If you flip that, then suddenly there's a whole other dimension to why these networks happening. Like what you've got is fungi, again, to use an economic analogy, which is going to be wrong, fungi controlling the not so much the means of production, but the supply. They control this kind of global network of trade, and they get to set the prices of whatever they're interested in.
Yeah.
They have control over this entire system of production.
Mm. But it's also like a response to the outside world that they'll somehow inherently know how much and where to send their supplies, which, again, spiritual maybe.
Yeah. It's crazy.
Jakes, crazy indeed. Okay, I have one question that perhaps flips everything. So we've been looking at how nature is queer. Mm-hmm. So now if we look at humans and queer people, why are queer people so fascinated with nature? Why is everyone I know, all my gays studying environmental-based science? I mean, obviously that's a gross generalization, but if you think about it, even like there's the lesbians, they love their hiking. Like, why is this?
Mm. And the frog in cranberries and the snail on a toadstool. Totally. Yeah. I think that's actually really true. And I think cottage it might court. Just be as simple as recognizing the kind of same queerness. You know, you don't even, it's almost like, you know,
looking in a mirror,
you know how we as queer people will form friendships and we don't mean to exclude cisheads
or do we?
But it's just, we always gravitate to each other without even knowing. There are entire like groups of friendships that I've heard about that start in year seven with a whole bunch of kids who think that they are cishetero.
Oh my God.
And then by the end of year 12 or halfway into uni, whatever, none of them are straight. Half of them are non-binary.
Your gender is working.
It's like we just kind of gravitate towards each other, right?
Yeah.
I feel like that's my guess for the same thing happening. We recognize the strangeness of it and find it really comforting rather than the constructed, really simple social values that we're told to value.
I reckon I agree. It's funny to think about, even like the
that's
social
a really
groups.
Good way to flip it. That's really interesting.
Yeah, I just thought it was funny. Okay, I have one more question I just thought of.
Yes,
if you want. And
please,
on a totally,
I've talked way too much, please.
On a broad note, in the news yesterday, the Australian government have finally announced that they want to make all or most cars or whatever carbon neutral by 2030. That's like their main climate goal. So I know, yeah, it's a bit of a good one. What do you think is the best way that we can protect Mother, if you will, Mother Earth?
Yes. I think, well, part of it, and this is going to be in some of the stuff that I'll send you, part of it is to stop calling her mother.
Yeah.
And to, well, not necessarily, but, you know, I think there are reconceiving our relationship with nature. We have to keep reminding ourselves that we need nature to survive.
Yeah, I feel like
that's,
especially with some like the cities expanding out, I think it's very easy to,
it's such a contradictory way to exist and to have these kind of values, right? So I think we do need to have these kind of conversations where we reconceive our relationship with nature, because otherwise we will keep having the same set of values. As far as that goes. There are a whole bunch of really defeatist things that I keep feeling about the fact that it is an extraordinarily tangled web of terrible processes acting themselves out on people and on the environment. And I don't think it's actually productive to keep sharing them because they're all I think about. It is as simple as the fact that all of this is connected. If you need to have a set of values which are anti-racist, they are anti-trans and homophobic, they are feminist, they are all of these things, and we have to rip apart the current way in which we do our capitalist, consumerist economy. Because otherwise I start getting scared about, even if we do survive this with technology, technology is not going to save people. Technology is going to save the current processes that allow this to happen in the first place. And so the people who will win are the bad people. And I think we'll get left behind if it's a technology-based solution. So it's just as simple as protest and vote. And we have 10 years to turn stuff around. Or less, slightly less than 10 years. And that's it. We've kind of got we've got a due date. You know, it's not just a thing of we need to get this done as soon as possible.
Bit of morning existentialism.
We have 10 years and we have to use it. And it's just as simple as that. You've got to fight really hard and do the right thing, uphold the values that you find really important and fight for them and incorporate them into a set of values that allows you to care for the whole world, all of it, all the nature that we can kind of pick apart the definition of. But the other thing that I would say is that the more I kind of try to understand activism, the more I realize that you have to have people who are compromising and people who are going to the extremes at the same time. You've got, as much as it frustrates me that Labor is useless at actually saying anything worthwhile right now, you've got to have them as much as you've got to have the values that I actually believe in that you see protesting for the school strike marches. You know, you've got to have both before anything happens, and it's not worth fighting each other about where we've ended up on that spectrum, as long as we're doing something and we're applying force across the whole spectrum, something will change, and that's all we can ask for right now. We can't be beggars and choosers.
Yeah, it's too late. Grams, that's a really nice way to finish. You brought everything together there.
I hope it's... Oh, God.
That was great. Well, thanks, everyone, for listening. Lichen, it's pretty good. It's pretty queer. And pretty cool. So are we. We're cool. Like, comment, subscribe. Tune in next week. And message at Trees with Squill if you have any questions for Dr. Finn. Because... I'm sure all 20 of you are ravenous. Thanks, Ben.
Me so feel great after that episode. Would you believe you've just been listening to Trees with Squill, hosted by Squillum. Music track Insane by Alfonso on Bandcamp, produced and recorded by Squillum. Follow at Trees with Squill on Instagram for more. See you next time. Okay.